Amen. Amen. Karibuni sana. Welcome. I will give the mic to Mrs. Beth Kirago to greet us, then to pray for the speaker, and then she'll welcome the speaker for us. Karibu.
Hallelujah. Bwana asifiwe. Somebody praise the Lord. Anybody who has a breath, praise the Lord. Give God glory. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Amen, amen. You may have your seats. We are so glad this morning. We are just from the express service, and I was telling the express service that the express means chap chap blessings. So we have just received the express blessings, and now we are in the celebration mood. I can see people celebrating here. I joined my pastor because I call him my pastor. Deuri, in thanking all of you that celebrated us last Saturday, Bwana asifiwe. We didn't feel loved, we didn't feel as a family, we didn't feel that we belonged. May the Lord bless you, may the Lord increase you, may you also be celebrated, Bwana asifiwe sana. Before the year ends, may the Lord give you a reason to celebrate. We want to thank God. I was sharing with the other service and I told them something that blessed me yesterday. I was going through the book of John. And in John chapter 20, verse 19, I met this episode where Jesus had just resurrected. And the disciples were in a house. The Bible says they were fearing. It was in the evening, so it was dark. You know when the situations are dark, church? So it was dark. And they were hiding themselves and had locked themselves. The Bible says the doors were locked. But Jesus appeared to them. One as if he were. I don't know whose doors is locked this morning. I don't understand. You may be looking for every avenue for your help. But as the word of God comes this morning, I want to assure you that your doors, Jesus will show up on your behalf. I remembered as I was sharing that this morning, of a time that I was going through issues. And one of my friends, I asked her, "Kwani Mungu alifunga kila mlango na kaida na funguo?" And she looked at me at the face and she told me, "Ben, God closes a door and opens another. So if anybody beba funguo, alimefunga kila kila avenue, akona milago igini atafugua." Na kwa kweli, I've seen God opening other doors, and I want to thank God. So this morning, be expectant. This morning, know that the Lord is here for you. So without more ado, I want to pray for the man of God, and we want to thank God for this service. Our Father and our God, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you this morning that indeed you are Father. Indeed, we can come to you, my Father, and call you Abba Father. As my Father, your word come to us this morning, which is settled in heaven. We want to thank you because, my Father, it will edify some of us, my God. It will give solution to some of us, my God. It will encourage somebody here who is, my Father, discouraged, to the glory and honor of your name, my God. And at the end of the day, Jehovah God, the glory and the honor shall be unto your holy name. My Father, we sit in this sanctuary, waiting to hear from you, my Father. Use Reverend Kirago, my Father, as a vessel of the hour, my God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and we give thanks. Amen.
Bwana asifiwe. Clap vizuri for my wife. She's a blessing to my life, and I appreciate her. You know, I was telling the express that she started praying for me before we met, because God gave her my name even before we had met. And she started, God told her, "Pray for my servant." By then I had just cleared campus. I didn't look like a servant. I was hassling. But God still called me his servant, and she continued praying for me until we met. And the rest is history. So I thank God for her and I honor her. I also want to honor our dad and mom who are not with us this morning for giving us an opportunity to share the word of God. It is a great privilege. This is their altar. We are here to support them. So when they give us an opportunity to share the word, it is always a privilege. And we honor them wherever they are. We pray that God may bless them, increase them, and give them more years that we can serve under them. They are great blessings. I've served under many ministries. But I can tell you that we have a father in this house and we have a mother in this house. And we seriously need to pray for them and support them for the great work that they are doing. Praise the Lord. This morning I want to share on a topic, understanding the blood covenant and the Holy Communion. I may share just one part. I may not be able to go through the rest, but I want to really look at understanding the blood covenant. One of the things that we really need to understand is that blood is very powerful. If you look at every culture and every tribe, they use blood in most of their ceremonies or in most of the things that they do. And blood is very key. If you go to a witch, they ask live animals because they need blood. Almost every covenant, every binding things is consummated with blood. So there is power in the blood. And if us as a church, we can understand the power that is in the blood, we can be able to do exploit. The people in the other world, that is the world of the devil, they understand the power in the blood. And that's why they keep on demanding it, and that's why they keep on pouring it, because they know as long as there is pouring of blood, there is accomplishment of that which they want. So we must also, as the children of God, come to a place where we understand the power that is in the blood of Jesus. Revelation 12:10 says that he overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. You know, I was looking at the meaning of that, and the word of their testimony is testifying about the power of the blood. When you testify, when you declare the power that is in the blood of Jesus, you are testifying the power, and you are able to manifest or experience the power that is in the blood of Jesus. So we need to pray, cover ourselves, cover our nation, declare the power that is in the blood of Jesus in our areas of operation, because there is power in the blood of Jesus. From the beginning in the book of Genesis, when Adam and Eve sinned, the Bible says that God provided for them a covering of skin. That tells us an animal died. An innocent animal had to die for God to cover the sins of Adam and Eve and be able to relate with them. And from that moment on, we see for God to relate with man, he has to make a covenant. Talking about Cain and Abel, the Bible says that in Genesis 4, the offering of Abel was made of lambs, choice lambs. But the one of Cain was made of crops. Crops don't have blood. But the lambs that Abel offered before God, they had blood. And that's why God accepted the offering of Abel, because of the blood. Because from that moment on, God had to relate on man on basis of blood covering their sin. So blood is king. I was telling the first service, you look at when the communities are making peace. You look at the Saburu and Pokot. When they are meeting, the elders are meeting, and they are eating together. They eat the meat, and there is also the shedding of blood, because they know, those communities, they know that for them to make an everlasting covenant about peace among themselves, they must pour blood. They just show us them eating meat on television, but they don't show us what they do with the blood. But there are other things that they do with the blood that is not brought to the media. They can't agree it to be brought to the media because it is sacred to them. So there is power in the blood of Jesus. I want us to read from the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 15 from verse 1. Sometime later, the Lord spoke to Abraham in a vision and said to him, "Do not be afraid, Abraham, for I will protect you and your reward will be great." But Abraham replied, "O sovereign Lord, what good are all your blessings when I don't even have a son, since you have given me no children? Eliezer of Damascus, a servant in my household, will inherit all my wealth. You have given me no descendant of my own, so one of my servants will be my heir." Then the Lord said to him, "No, your servant will not be your heir, for you will have a son of your own, who will be your heir." Then the Lord took Abraham outside and said to him, "Look up into the sky and count the stars. If you can, that's how many descendants you will have. And Abraham believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous because of his faith. Then the Lord told him, I am the Lord who brought you out of the Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land as your possession. But Abraham replied, O sovereign Lord, how can I be sure that I will actually possess it? I want us to read that together again. But Abraham replied, O sovereign Lord, how can I be sure that I will actually possess it? Abraham is asking God, I want a contract. In today's language, I want us to go to a lawyer and sign this thing down. Because you are promising. You have promised me a son, an heir. You have promised me a lad. You have promised me that you bless me. But I want evidence that I can stand on these things, that I can rely on what you are telling me. So he's telling him, I don't just want your word. I want something concrete. I want something that I can stand on, that these things are going to come to pass. Let's continue. Then the Lord told him, bring me a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old female goat, a three-year-old lamb and turtle dove, and a young pigeon. So Abraham presented all these to him and killed them. Then he cut each animal down the middle, laid the halves side by side. He did not, however, cut the birds in half. Some vultures swooped down to eat the carcass, but Abraham chased them away. As the sun was going down, Abraham fell into a deep sleep, and a terrifying darkness came down over him. Then the Lord said to Abraham, you can be sure that your descendants will be strangers in a foreign land, where they will be oppressed as slaves for 400 years. But I will punish the nation that enslaved them, and in the end, they will come away with great wealth. As for you, you will die in peace and be buried at ripe old age. After four generations, your descendant will return here to this land, for the sins of the Amorites do not yet warrant their destruction. After the sun went down and darkness fell, Abraham saw a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch pass between the halves of the carcasses. So this is the covenant that God made with Abraham. After Abraham asked God, how can I be sure that I will possess these things? God knew where Abraham was coming from. He came from the east, and the people from the east understood the power of covenant. They dealt with covenant. If anything, there was to be an agreement, there must have to be a cutting of the covenant. So when Abraham asked God, how am I going to be sure? God understood that Abraham is asking for a covenant. The only difference between this covenant that Abraham made with God is that only one person walked between the two animals. In the olden time or in the eastern, they would cut the two animals along the backbone. They would put one piece on this side and the other piece on this side. And then the blood will be poured in between. And the two parties that are making covenant, they would walk. One would walk from that edge and the other one would walk from this edge. And then they would meet at the middle and make declaration or make the covenant. So they would declare that if I don't keep the word of this covenant, if I don't protect you when you need my protection, if I don't provide for you when you need me to provide for you, then let me be killed and my blood be poured like the blood of these animals. So they would walk, and they would walk in a pattern that follows an eight. You know, eight, like that. Eight start for infinity, meaning that the covenant could not be broken. The moment you walk down the blood, you meet at the middle, you make the, you declare the blessings and the curses. If you read Deuteronomy 28-27, there is the declaration of the blessings and the curses. The moment you walk down between the two halves and declare the blessings and the curses, the covenant is completely sealed. So God tell Abraham, make the two halves. Then the Bible says, a deep sleep came upon Abraham and he slept. Then in a vision, he saw two things. He saw a torch and a smoking pot. Those two were used in the eastern area or in the eastern people. They used them during making of covenant and also during marriage, because marriage is also a covenant. You read in Matthew 25 about the 10 wise virgins. They had oil, the torches of making the covenant. So the two torches, or the smoking pot and the fire pot, represented the presence of God or the divine presence, meaning that God is witness of the covenant that you are making between the two. So this time, it is only God who walked between the two halves, meaning that he's telling God, I don't want you to walk between the two halves because you cannot be able to keep the covenant. But me, I'm committing myself that if I don't do that which I'm promising you, if I don't give you a son, then I will cease to be God. If I don't give you this land, and after 400 years bring your children back here, and they possess this land, then I will cease to be God. If I don't bless you and protect you, then I will cease to be God. So Abraham from that moment understood that I am a covenant man. I'm protected by God. I have a greater one who watches over me. Any community, for example, a Maasai community would make a covenant with a Kikuyu community. Maasai is a warring community. They would make a covenant with Kikuyu and tell them, if I am attacked, I will call upon you, and you come and protect me. The Maasai will tell them, if I have hunger or I'm going through famine, you will provide for me. If one of the community break the covenant, the other one had a right to attack and steal and kill them. So that's how strong the covenant was. So from that moment on, Abraham understood that I have a greater one who is protecting me. And that's why in Genesis 14, the Bible says that there was a war between five kings and four kings. And his nephew Lot was taken by the five kings. And then the Bible says, Abraham with 318 men followed the four kings, attacked them, and recovered everything. How can one man with 318 men defeat five kings who had defeated four kings, unless he had a heart of God? So from that moment, Abraham, when going to war or following these enemies, he was not going in his own strength. He was going in the strength of the covenant that he had with God. And he knew that wherever I go, God is obliged to protect me and to fulfill that which he had promised me. In Genesis 20, we see him going to Abimelech. And the Bible says that when he arrived there, he talked to the wife and told her, you are beautiful, and these people may kill me because of you. So when we arrive here, let's agree. When they ask about you, you say that you are my sister. And then Abraham, Sarah also said, so when they arrived, the king asked about them, and Abraham said, she's my sister. Sarah was also asked, and she said, he's my brother. And then the Bible says, if you read verse 6, that God visited King Abimelech at night and told him, you are a dead man. The lady that you took is a married woman. And then Abimelech says, I was innocent. I did it out of innocence. I asked, and they said they are brothers and sister. Will you destroy an innocent man? The Bible says God told her, told King Abimelech, I kept you from touching her. It is God who protected Sarah. Who had sinned? Is it King Abimelech? No. It is Abraham and Sarah who had lied. But now, God is going to King Abimelech. He's not going to Abraham. He's telling you, you are as good as dead. Because the man you are touching, or the wife that you have in your house, belong to a man that I have a covenant with. And whatever you do to this lady, you are doing it to me. If you touch her, it means you are touching me. Because we are in a covenant with him. I'm obliged to protect the wife of my covenant partner. And the men who are here, unless God told you, if you have a beautiful lady in your house, and if you read Genesis 20, it was not one night. Because the Bible says after some time. So Sarai was in Abimelech's house for some time. And the king had asked for her, not to be a house help, but to be a wife. But God kept him from touching her. That is the power of the covenant. that God could protect, he would keep the man from touching the wife of his covenant brother. So there is power when we understand that. And I want us to look at the 8 steps of making a covenant. How did they make a covenant? We can, and I will try to compare it with how Jesus made a covenant with us. Because we are in a covenant with Jesus. God deals with men by covenant. So there are traditional steps in making blood covenant of friendship. We are going to read from the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. After David had finished talking with Saul, he met Jonathan, the king's son. There was an immediate bond of love between them, and they became the best of friends. From that day on, Saul kept David with him and wouldn't let him return home. Verse 3. And Jonathan made a solemn pact with David because he loved him as he loved himself. Verse 4. Jonathan sealed the pact by taking off his robe and giving it to David, together with his tunic, sword, bow, and belt. These are the things that, you know, Jonathan gave to David. He gave him his tunic, that is the cloth that he was wearing, or the coat that he was wearing. He gave him his sword, his bow, and his belt. So one of the first step that any community or any two peoples that were making a covenant would do is the exchange of coat. The exchange of coat. The exchange of coat. A coat signifies the identity and authority of a person entering the covenant. If I give you the coat, or if I give you my coat, it signifies, or it is stands for my identity and the authority the person making or entering the covenant. The exchange meant everything one represents have now belong to the other person. If I give you my coat, everything that is in that coat, or all that I am, now belongs to you, and everything that I represent also belongs to you. All my possession, all that I am, my very self, I give to you. I'm no longer my own, I belong to you. So you are declaring that all that I am now belongs to you. So Jonathan gave him his robe, telling him, everything I represent now belongs to you. Jonathan was the apparent heir to the throne. We knew that. And that's why the father kept on telling him that you are helping David and he will take the throne from you. So he was the apparent heir to the throne when his father died. But by giving his coat to David, he was saying, you can ascend to the throne after my father. The blood covenant was renewed in 1 Samuel 20, 13 to 20, verse 15. Of 1 Samuel 26, I do not ever cut off your kindness from my family, not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth. Jonathan kept on reminding David that even when I'm gone, don't ever cut our loving kindness or your loving kindness my family. In verse 17 of 1 Samuel 26, and Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath out of love for him because he loved him as he loved himself. After the death of Saul and Jonathan, David looked for Mephibosheth. We all know the story of Mephibosheth. After Saul and Jonathan had been killed, David reached a point and asked, is there anyone remaining from the family of Jonathan that I may show them kindness because of my friend, Jonathan? David had to keep the vow. They had made a covenant with Jonathan, and he had to keep this. David asked, is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? Don't be afraid. When he called Mephibosheth, this is what he said. Don't be afraid, David said to him, for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table. David had to keep the promise he made to his covenant partner, Jonathan. He had to look for him and show him kindness. Even when Mephibosheth said that, who am I for you to favor me? I'm a dead dog. But because of the covenant that he had with Jonathan, he had to get him back and take care of him. On the cross of Calvary, Jesus exchanged our quote. He took our sin nature and gave us his righteousness nature. The Bible says, him who knew no sin, he became sin that we may become the righteousness of God. So as Jesus was hanging on the cross, he was making a covenant between us and God. He was taking off his nature. And that's why the Bible says that, you know, we are sons of God. He became a son of man that we may become the sons of God. He became like us so that we can become like a God. So he gave himself for us. He became sin that we may become the righteousness of God in him. All that he represents became our portion. He identified with us so that we can be identified with him. We can have authority. We can. And that's why he would tell his disciples that the things I do, you do greater things than this. Why? Because he's identified and with us. He made us to be like him. He took our possession that we can be like him. And that's why he had confidence and saying that, Lord, you know, as the story goes, when, you know, when he went to heaven, there's this story that goes that, you know, an angel asked him, I know, you have let the work in the hearts of the 12 men if they fail. But Jesus was confident in this, that they cannot fail, because he had taken our position and he has made us to take his position. And this morning, he's still confident that the church cannot fail. And that's why he said in Matthew 18, that I'm building my church and the gate of hell shall not prevail against it. Because he knows the same nature he had, the same power that he had, we have it. It's only sometimes we walk in ignorance, but we are so powerful, we can shape the destiny of this nation if we walk in the covenant that we have with God. Our words have power. Just as his words had power, our words had power. Because he has taken our possession and he has given us his possession. He gave his power, he gave us power and authority in his name. The Bible says that he has given us a name that is above all other name. That by the name of Jesus, everything shall bow in heaven and in earth. By the use of that name, we can command situation, we can command things because of the covenant that we have with God. We are not begging. We are going as brothers and, you know, and sister to our Father. He has opened a way for us to enter into the holiest of holies so that we can be able to decree and declare things and they can be established unto us because of our position with him. We are not going as people who are trying to beg God. He has already adopted us into the sonship. The second one is the exchange of the weapon belt. If you read that first, the Bible says he gave him his bow. So on this belt is the bow or the bow, the knife, the sword, or any other weapon. This exchange signifies that all my strength now belongs to you. When you give your covenant partner your belt, it means that all my strength, because the weapons are the one that you use to face the enemy. Your enemy are now my enemies. And your friends are now my friends. By Jonathan giving David his bow or the weapon, he was telling him, from this moment on, your enemies are my enemies. And your friends are my friends. And that's why Jonathan had to protect, because he understood the covenant. That's why he had to protect him even from his father. Because as long as Saul becomes an enemy of David, then he's an enemy of Jonathan. Regardless of the relationship they have, because covenant is stronger than anything else. So Jonathan was obliged even to protect David from his own father because of the covenant that he had. Your enemies are now my enemies. My friends are your friends. I will be there to serve you you've ever needed, and vice versa. That is in 1 Samuel 8:4. Jonathan took off the robe he was wearing and gave it to David, along with his tunic and even his sword, his bow and belt. Jonathan protected David from even his own father. Jesus exchanged our weapon belt. He gave us power and authority to tread upon snakes and scorpions, and nothing shall hurt us. He has given us power to cast out demons and heal the sick. In Ephesians 6:13-18, he has given us the full armor of God, that when the day of evil comes, we may be able to stand. Jesus took our weaknesses. By ourselves, we could not face the enemy. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 10:3, that our weapon of warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to pull down stronghold and everything that tried to exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Our weapon are mighty because they are weapon that we have been given by God. We are not using our own weapon. We are not using our own wisdom as we face the enemy. We are using the weapon of God because Jesus exchanged. He gave us his belt in Ephesians 6. Put on the full armor of God. It is the armor of God so that we can face the enemy using the armor of God. The third stage is the exchange of vows in the work of blood. The exchange of vows in the work of blood. An animal was sacrificed by splitting it down the backbone. Usually it was a bull, a goat, or a ram. The halves were laid open with a pool of blood between them. The covenant would walk in a figure eight between the halves and meet in the middle in the pool of the blood. They would meet face to face and declare the blessings and curses of the covenant. The curses are usually pronounced against anyone who would break this covenant. It is usually said like this: the one who breaks this covenant will die like this. Just as the animal gave its life, so I will give my life if necessary. So there was that, the exchange of vow in the work of blood. As the two partners are walking in the blood, they would make the vows. They would declare the blessings and the curses. Jonathan had davidly affirmed his oath that he will never cut his loving kindness to the family of Jonathan and those that Saul killed. Galatians 3:13-14. The Bible says that Christ redeemed us from the curse by becoming a curse for us, so that the blessings of Abraham may come to the Gentiles through him. On the cross, he said, it is finished, meaning that it is completely completed and perfectly perfected. On the cross, where his blood was shed, it was the work of the blood. And because he knew, God knew, that we could not be able to keep the part of the covenant, Jesus went alone on the cross, and he did it. That's why the Bible says that we are saved by faith, by grace, through faith. We just put our trust in what Christ did on Calvary. Christ died there. As he hung there, God was making a covenant with us. The blood was shed so that the covenant can be completely sealed. Number four, the accounting of all belongings for exchange. The accounting of all belongings for exchange. While they are still standing in the pool of the blood, one would give an account of everything they owned. If you have money in the bank, you'd write it down and say, I have this much in my account. I have this property here and there. The two partners that are making the covenant, they would come to a place where they say, this is how much I own. And the other person would say, this is how much I own. And from that moment on, if we make a covenant with Sangula, who is my home cell pastor, and we say, or we make such kind of obliged to reveal everything that I own to him. If I have money in the bank, I would tell him. And if at one moment he needs the money and come to me, because of the covenant, I'm obliged to give it to him without question. So there was that accounting of belonging. They would start in the pool of the blood and they would account for everything that they owed. Christ became poor, that through his property we became rich. On the cross, he was accounting for his blessing. He accounted for everything that he had. The Bible says he became poor that we may become rich. Everything that he has, we have access to because of the covenant that we have in him. With you, you know, there was a great exchange. The Bible says he became sin that we may become the righteousness of God. He became poor that we may become the rich. He became a son of man that we may become the sons of God. There was a great exchange that took place at the cross. He was giving us all that he was, that we may be, because we are his covenant brothers. Number five, the exchange of names. The exchange of names. When there was that making of covenant, each participant takes the other's name to himself. The person names or the person's name represent his individuality, thus demonstrate the death of being an individual. Anywhere you go, if you mention the name of a higher person or a big person, the doors open for you. If you say, I'm sent by President Uhuru, I don't think anybody will stop you. So in the covenant making process, there was exchange of names. In covenant, you are no longer concerned with yourself. Your concern now includes your blood covenant brother. If, for example, I'm Simon Njoroge Kirago, if I'm making covenant with Beth, my name will change. So I will be called Simon Wanjiku Kirago. That's how they were changing the name, Simon Wanjiku Kirago. And Beth will be Beth Kirago Wanjiku. That's how they were exchanging. Meaning, wherever I go, I represent her. Whatever I have belong to her. And that's why maybe even in marriage, I think we are better and fair men. The ladies change their names and take our names, but we don't take their names. And maybe that's why we still think that everything that we have still belong to us. But in true covenant, we are supposed to exchange that whatever I have becomes or belongs to Beth. And whatever Beth has belongs to me. So if she needs anything, she doesn't need to beg me, because we are in covenant. It is a partnership. It is a complete partnership. Everything that we have belongs to all of us. They exchange name to mean that who I am, I'm no longer living for myself. I'm no longer living for what I believe in, but I'm now living a double life. I'm living for you, and I can do anything for you. And that's why, you know, Peter's talking about prayer, and he says that, men, if you don't treat your wives with wisdom, your prayer will not be heard, because they are covenant partners. The way you treat them will help you to activate the covenant or enjoy the blessings of the covenant or hinder the blessings of the covenant. So it is a very powerful covenant. That's for another day. But marriage is also a covenant. There was, in the traditional marriage, all these steps were followed when a marriage was being consummated. So the number six is, so Jesus exchanged, before we go to number six, Jesus exchanged our names on Calvary. He became the Son of Man that we may become the sons and daughters of God. He became sin that we may become the righteousness of God in him. He became poor that we may become rich. He was rejected that we may be accepted. He gave us his name. And that's why we can boldly go before God and call him Father. Because he gave us the sons, the title, the sons and daughters of God. Number six is the exchange of blood. What they used to do in the traditional making of covenant is they would cut your wrist. You give your wrist and it would cut. And the other part in a wrist would be cut. They would either do, you bring the two wrists that are cut and the two blood would mix, or the mingling of the blood. So that was one of it. And because we know that the life is in the blood, meaning I've given you my life, you have given me your life. Or the other one was, either you put the blood in a container. Both partner would put the blood in a container. Then they would add wine. And then you would drink it. So that was all the other way. The third way was to replace blood with wine. They would put wine in a beaker or a glass, and both of them would drink from the same beaker. Meaning, my life I've given over to you. And you see in marriage, sometimes people, after eating the cake, they drink from the same glass, or they exchange. You give your juice to your partner. That's a part of the covenant. It was part of the covenant. So, in some culture, the blood from both participants was dashed into a cup of wine and stirred together. And then the two participants drink from the common cup. so that each one's blood enter into the other. The mingling of blood, creating this new union, one of ones, is why this is called the blood covenant. That's why it was called the blood covenant. It is a strong bond of relationship known to human. It is the way God has chosen to interact with all humanity. The reason why Jesus died on the cross was to cut a covenant. The spilled blood of Jesus called the blood of everlasting covenant. The blood of Jesus is called the blood of the everlasting covenant. As he hanged on the cross, Jesus was both fully man and fully God. So as he hanged there, there was the intermingling of the blood of man and the blood of God, so that the covenant can be fully fulfilled. So it is the blood of everlasting covenant. Satan could not understand what was happening at the cross. Only one party was represented. And that's why the Bible says that if he had known, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 7 to 8, now we speak of God's secret wisdom. 1 Corinthians 2, 7 and 8. Now we speak of God's secret wisdom, a wisdom that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before the time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. You know, when Jesus was hanging there, the enemy could not understand because it is only one party. So to him, there was no covenant. But to God, Jesus was fully man and fully God. So the kingdom of heaven was fully represented and man was fully represented. So the covenant partner were both of them represented there. So if the enemy had understood, he would not have crucified the Lord because the covenant would not have been established. Jesus was fully man and fully God. When the blood of Jesus was spilled on the cross, the blood of human family and the blood of divinity were spilled and mingled together, establishing the everlasting new covenant in his blood. It sealed the covenant between formerly hostile parties. That's why the Bible says he has reconciled us to God. Number 7. It is the mark of the covenant. We are still standing in between the sacrificed animal with the blood dripping from the wood. Some dark substance such as charcoal would be rubbed on each arm. Where they were cut, they would rub the blood. So that even after you have healed, the mark will remain there. So wherever you went, people will look at you and know that you have a covenant person. So before they attack you, before they do anything, because they don't know the kind of a partner you have, they'll be careful. Any person who saw in the Eastern, if somebody saw a mark on a man's heart, they knew that he was a covenant. He had a covenant partner. And because of that, they would not attack him. The Bible is talking about Jesus when he is resurrected in John 20, 27. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my heart, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believing." After resurrection, he told Thomas, "Touch and see the scars." The scars were still there, meaning that the covenant is still remaining. We can trust on it. We can rely on it. We can stand on the covenant because it is an everlasting covenant. Nothing can alter it. Nothing can break it. And the last one is the covenant meal. The covenant meal. The exchange consisted of bread and wine. They would break one bread and each place a piece of that bread into the covenant partner's mouth. When they did that, it signifies that a part into the other. Then they would drink wine from a common cup, indicating that their blood has gone to each other. So they would take a whole bread and they would break from each a piece and feed the covenant partner. And after that, it meant that have become covenant. And then they would drink the wine together. Since life is in the blood, they were demonstrating that they had taken each other's life. At the end of the blood covenant ceremony, the two covenant or primary participants are now friends. And they are now have a new relationship formed, that is a union called the covenant. This relationship with this union is now governed by an attitude to each other's called loving kindness. So the relationship between the two partners is called a loving kindness. And that's why Jonathan would tell David, don't cut your loving kindness. You read in the Bible in Psalms, David would keep on telling God, don't cut your loving kindness. Remember the covenant that you made with Abraham. Remember the relationship that we have with you because of the covenant that Abraham made with you. The relationship is governed by that. From the Hebrew word, that means hesed, and the Greek word agape. So in the Greek, it is agape, the unconditional love of God. And that's how we relate with God. Now, when we go to God, we relate to him. In Hebrew, it was loving kindness. In Greek or in the New Testament, it is unconditional agape or unconditional love. That's why when we go to God, we don't go on the basis of what we have done or not done. We go on the basis of his unconditional love. He loves us regardless. There's nothing that God can do that can stop him from loving us. He always loves us. And when we go to him, that's why we should go boldly, because there is no condemnation. Paul writes in Romans 8 and say, there is no condemnation for them that are in Christ Jesus. Because when we go to him, we are not going on our basis. We are going on the basis of what Christ did on Calvary. We are going on the basis of the finished work of Calvary. When God sees us, he sees us in Christ. And if you read the book, most of the letters of Paul, you hear him say, in Christ. We are more than conquerors in Christ. Because when he died, we are in him. So in him, we have victory. In him, we can conquer. In him, we have authority. We are now in a union with one another, and we are called blood brothers. Jesus shared a covenant meal with his disciples, and he instituted it as part of our worship. We eat the Lord's table. It was the meal of the covenant, that when we partake it together, we are saying that we are one with one another. And I was telling the first express service, one of the biggest challenges that we have as Christians is that we don't understand the covenant of blood. And therefore, we come here on Sunday, we eat the Holy Communion, declaring that we are blood brothers. Then we come out of church and you start talking about me. We have eaten a meal, we are declaring that we are covenant brothers, we are declaring that we are one, that you go out of your way to protect me, then you start attacking me. And that's why Paul would tell the Corinthians that's why some of you are weak and some of you have died, because you don't understand the Holy Communion. You eat and despise your brothers. But the moment we understand that we are covenant brothers, when you hear people talking about me, you protect me because I'm in covenant with you. We are brothers. We are one body. There is no way you can attack that which you belong to. It is said that the Christ or the Christians, it is the only army that kill their wounded army or men. When a brother has fallen, instead of restoring them with love, as according to Galatians 6:1, we start talking about them. We start attacking them. We kill them. But the moment we understand that we are in a covenant, we will protect each other. We will cover each other. We will, pray for them and not speak ill about her. When God started speaking to me about this, I'm very careful. And I was sharing, I don't know who I was sharing with, and I was telling him, from now on, if you are my friend and you come to talk to me about any brother, be sure of this, I will tell you no. Because I don't want to engage in things that will be for my detriment or for my harm. I want to protect my brothers. If you are telling me about my brother, will you be bold enough if they come and say, or they come and you can say what you are telling me? If you are bold enough, then we will talk about it and then pray about it. But if you not be bold enough to tell or to say what you are telling me in their presence, then what you are saying is not true and I don't need it. Because I need to walk in the covenant blessing. Because those are the things that are making the body of Christ to be weak. We don't understand the covenant. We keep on hitting each other. We keep on tearing each other down instead of strengthening each other. I was telling the service that I listened to a prophet called Prophet Owusu, and he said that they sat down with the wife and told, and he told her that when I go into the presence of God, the secret priest, he was teaching on Psalms 91, because the Bible says that he will protect me, he will hide me in his presence. Owusu told our wife that when I go into the secret place, though you are my wife, if you go out there and speak ill about me, you are my enemy. Because as I pray and ask God to protect me from my enemies, anybody who speaks ill about me is my enemy. So if I go out there, or I go into my secret place, and I start asking God to protect me from my enemies, and you are out there talking ill about me, then you are my enemy, and you'll be part of what God will be dealing with. So we must come to a place where we know that we are one body. We are in a covenant. We can't afford to speak ill about each other. We must come to a place where we love each other. Jesus called Judas my friend. The guy who betrayed him, he asked, when he kissed him, he told him, Fred, do what that which you are doing quickly. If we want to walk in the power of God, if we want to walk in the anointing of God, we must walk in love. We must walk in the unconditional love of God, because we are in a covenant of love. Love people. Don't be bothered about what they are saying about you. Don't discuss people. It will not help you. The Bible says, touch not my anointed, do my prophet no harm. Anybody that is called by God, they are God's prophet. Because a prophet is not anybody who just say that I'm a prophet. We all have the anointing of God upon our lives. So when you start criticizing, you are fighting what God is working on. And you become an enemy of God, because I am in a covenant with my God. So if you try to fight me, then you are fighting what God is doing in my life. So let's learn to walk in the love of God. Let's learn to forgive. Let's learn to release bitterness from our lives, because God will release the blessings of God in our lives. Let's rise on our feet. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you and we give you praise this morning. We honor you that you are our Father, O God. We thank you for the covenant, that relationship that we have in you, O God. That in Christ we are accepted this morning, O God. In Christ we are loved unconditionally, O God. In Christ, my Father, you fight every battle that come our way, O God. We want to declare, my Father, that as your children, my Father, that there are no weapon that formed against us that will prosper, my Father. And every tongue that rises against us in judgment, we refute, O God. We want to declare, my Father, our going out and our coming in is blessed of thee, O God. Wherever we go, my Father, your favor will speak on our behalf, O God. We shall trample upon serpents and scorpions, O God. Nothing shall harm us by all means, O God. We stand on the covenant that we have with you, O God. We bless ourselves, my Father, and declare, my Father, that we shall enjoy the blessings of Abraham, O God. Healing is our portion this morning, O God. Deliverance is our portion, O God, because we are covenant people, my Father. We thank you and we exalt your name, my Father. We want to declare, my Father, that anyone, my Father, that rises against us, oh God, you will fight them, King of Glory. As we walk in love, my Father, as we walk in covenant, oh God, may you scatter our enemies, oh God. We honor you this morning, oh God. Have your way, my Father. We bless the Father of this house, oh God. We bless the leadership of this nation, oh God. We declare, my Father, by the covenant that we have on within, my Father, as your servant, oh God, Kenya is blessed, my Father. Our children are blessed, my Father. We bless Reverend Mwethe, oh God. We are standing on the covenant that we have with thee, oh God. And from this altar, oh God, we are declaring his wholeness, oh God. We are declaring that he is rising again, oh God, because you are a covenant giving God, oh God. We worship you and we give you praise in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.